This is the Great World Amusement Theater. It has been an iconic landmark of Shanghai for nearly a century. On August 14th, 1937, a high explosive bomb was dropped right here. 600 lives perished in a single blast. That scorching Saturday will forever be remembered as the Black Saturday of Shanghai.
In 1937, this was the highest roof in Shanghai. And when war broke out, it was always filled with curious observers looking out over the district of Jiabe, where the fighting was fiercest.
The war that began in August 1937 was a violent disruption to the otherwise peaceful lives of the Westerners living in Shanghai at the time. The Americans, the Europeans, they could hardly believe that this war would affect them.
Not far away from this building, an American newspaperman, John Benjamin Powell, was watching the battle from the rooftop of his residence at Fuzhou Road. Like other curious foreigners, he didn't foresee the impending danger. After all, the Great World, Park Hotel, or Fuzhou Road were all located in the international settlement of Shanghai, the safest place in China. Powell didn't know that in merely 4 years, his own life would be in great danger. Later on, he would realize Shanghai would gradually lose its safety. His life and rights, as well as those of other foreigners and Chinese, would be violently disrupted. Their stories of survival tell a larger story of resistance, defiance, and resilience during the greatest and darkest period of war and destruction that humankind has ever known. My name is Andrew Field. I am a scholar of Chinese history from America. I've lived in Shanghai for many years. This documentary will take you back into the darkest chapter of Shanghai's history. It all started in 1937. August 1937, Shanghai. China's most modern city was embroiled in war. Japan, China's militant and imperialistic neighbor, had been encroaching on a weak China throughout the 1930s. In 1937, the Japanese military launched a full-scale invasion of China. Shanghai became one of the first battlegrounds of China's war of resistance. But not all residents of Shanghai were affected by the onset of war. A metropolis of more than 3 million people, Shanghai was a distillation of everything that made China modern in 1937. But it was a divided city. Shanghai was in effect three cities in one. It had two separate concessions run by the British, Americans, and French. Protected by their military presence and political neutrality, the concessions of Shanghai were considered safe havens. Even when the full-scale war broke out in 1937, the two belligerent sides carefully avoided the foreign settlements.
It was the opinion of the foreigners here. It was a war between Asians, between Japan and China, so it didn't seem that important. Remember, it was 1937 mentality. It was a colonial setup, quasi-colonialism. It was a war between Asian countries, really not our war.
But for J.B. Powell, the feeling was different. He was the editor and publisher of the China Weekly Review. China Weekly Review was one of the most well-known English language newspapers in Shanghai. Powell had lived in Shanghai for 20 years. He had covered many major events in a turbulent China. The Battle of Shanghai, for him, was an opportunity of a lifetime. He would frequently go to the rooftop of his residence and survey the situation. From there, he became an unwilling witness to the tragedy of Black Saturday.
J.B. Powell was standing on the rooftop of this building, watching the fights between the Chinese and Japanese planes when the bomb struck the great world. He immediately rushed to the scene, which was about 10 blocks away. And here's how he describes it in his memoir. The explosion shook
the entire city. I hurried to the scene, and for the first time in my extensive coverage of battles, I actually saw human blood running in the gutters. So I think that pretty much summarizes the kind of career and his what he was all about. He was a war correspondent, you know, and that kind of coverage is what he lived for, being in that position to witness these horrific events of history.
Nine days after Black Saturday on August 23, another large-scale tragedy occurred on the busiest shopping district of the International Settlement. Air bombs landed between two of Shanghai's leading department stores, the Sincere and Wing On. Hundreds of men, women, and children were slaughtered in the blast, and the streets filled with screams and with carnage.
Between August and September, the fighting intensified, with bombs raining down from the skies, indiscriminately killing thousands of people regardless of nationality. And at that point, insecurity and even panic hit the international population of Shanghai.
That sentiment was faithfully captured in an American newsreel of the time.
Americans begin quitting the city of terror. This is no place for innocent neutrals, and Uncle Sam wants no part of the Orient struggles. These are the first of 4,000 to be taken away.
Powell did not want to leave. He had lived in Shanghai for two decades. Shanghai was his home. J.B. Powell came from Hannibal, Missouri, a small hinterland town of America where people had very little knowledge about foreign lands.
I think my grandfather wanted, really desired a bigger life than he could have possibly had in Missouri. That where he grew up is a very tiny little town. Like right in the middle of the United States, you know? And if there wasn't a huge river running right next to it, he wouldn't have been able to escape.
Powell's first escape was to Columbia, Missouri. Here, he graduated from the first class of the world's first journalism school. After working on a local newspaper upon graduation, J.B. was offered a job from a Missouri alumnus, Thomas Millard, who operated a newspaper titled Millard's Review of the Far East in Shanghai, China.
So this was like this remarkable opportunity that just came to him. And so he said, of course, to go to China to start a newspaper. I mean, what could be more exciting than that, you know? I mean, there a lot was going on in China that was in upheaval. It was a place where news was being made, and he wanted to be there. And so he took the job, and he left his wife and his daughter in Hannibal, Missouri, and he went to China in 1917. he very much enjoyed China and living there, and he liked Chinese. He became a Chinaphile, you know, somebody who actually loved it, you know, went there and fell in love with the country.
In 1922, J.B. took over Millard's paper and changed the masthead to China Weekly Review. He quickly established himself and the newspaper. But his beloved China would soon suffer from its aggressive neighbor, Japan. His own opposition to the Japanese invasion was unequivocal, consistent, and bitter. He believed that to resist the stronger Japanese, China must be united. In 1936, the China Weekly Review became the first Western newspaper to publish an exclusive interview of the Chinese communist leader, Mao Zedong. The interview was conducted by one of Powell's former assistant editors and his fellow Missouri alumnus, Edgar Snow. It was the first time for Western readers around the world to read about the Chinese Communist Party and its strategies for fighting the Japanese. Later on, correspondent reports handpicked by Powell to publish would frequently show the world the determination of the communist-led 8th Route Army to fight the Japanese to the last man.
They have no gloves, often no socks, and their shoes are often rags worn down to the frozen earth. Yet they fight on, fighting for their families, their homes, and their country. The 8th Ralph Army had an expression heard on the lips of every man in its ranks. Wherever a Chinese stands, that is our front and our rear, that is our base. Wherever there is Chinese territory, that is our base.
In Shanghai, Powell personally reported a famous battle where a surrounded battalion of Chinese troops fought defiantly against an overwhelming Japanese force.
The Japanese attacked the godown with heavy artillery, incendiary bombs, and anti-aircraft guns. The Chinese used hand grenades frequently with devastating effect. The lone battalion will go down in Chinese history as the whole Chinese nation watched it defy practically the whole of the Japanese forces in the Shanghai area.
J.B. Powell, the editor of this newspaper, the China Weekly Review, had been against Japanese aggression in China ever since 1931. And if you read this newspaper from 1937, when the war broke out around Shanghai, you can see that the newspaper is taking an anti-Japanese stance. And he even went so far as to lobby for the American government to become involved on the China side against Japanese aggression.
But across the Pacific Ocean, Americans did not want to join the war. Still coming out of the Great Depression, the United States experienced a recession in 1937. Focused on domestic issues and pursuing a policy of isolation, the U.S. government chose not to engage with the brewing war in the Far East.
America hates war. America. America hopes for peace. Therefore, America actively engages in the search for peace.
The United States tried to maintain neutrality because we were selling munitions to the Japanese. We were supplying them with iron, steel, copper, all the metals that they were buying, and they bought all the way through the first part of World War II. They were still buying. It's shocking, but that's the nature of capitalism. It knows no boundaries, you know. It's not wedded to any country, or it's only driven by profiteering.
The British and French took similar approaches. They shored up their defenses in their enclaves in Shanghai, but remained neutral. As an American, Powell was as lonely as China, fighting an undeclared war with Japan amidst a prevalent atmosphere of appeasement. Shanghai suffered greatly from the policy of appeasement. It became one of the first metropolises in the world to bear the full brunt of modern warfare. And the district of Jiabei was the epicenter of devastation. It was the target of 136 attacks, 48 shellings, and 98 aerial bombings. The Japanese troops set the entire neighborhood on fire pressed the Chinese army out of the area. Jiabei burned for 3 whole days in late October, and the district was razed to the ground.
Jiabei, 在1937年的时候，国民政府把它叫做中国城市当中自治的模范。它是个模范城区，是中国人自己建的，它有很好的道路、桥梁、企业，包括商务印书馆。 就在那儿，还有大量的新兴的街区，人们很安详的生活。但是由于战争是这里是一个很重要的一个战区，战争过了以后，只有一幢房子，3层楼了，它本来没有名字，后来所有的中国人都叫它三层楼，就这幢房子没有倒塌，整个的闸北全部砸毁，包括商务印书馆。
This is Suzhou River, and like the Thames in London and the Seine in Paris, it runs through the heart of the city. In 1937, it was the demarcation line between war and peace. And the bridges over this river were bridges of life and death.
North of the Suzhou River is war-torn Jiabei, and south of the Suzhou River is the safe international settlement. Thousands of refugees fled through the streets, heading for bridges that led into the international settlement. A Western witness recalled a mad and merciless stampede on the Garden Bridge. Half a dozen times I knew I was walking on the bodies of children or old people, sucked under by the torrent, trampled flat by countless feet.
Well, I was about 10 years old, right? I saw dead bodies when I was riding my bicycle. They were in straw bags on the street corners, and I realized later on it was little children who had died because of famine or the cold at night, and their mothers abandoned them.
The Battle of Shanghai was fought between a nation that hadn't lost a war in nearly a century and a nation that hadn't won a war in the same time period. The outcome was inevitable. After 3 months of serious fighting, the Chinese forces were defeated and retreated, leaving the area that surrounded the two foreign concessions open to Japanese occupation. The two foreign concessions themselves became a lone island, or Gudao.
As the Chinese troops withdrew towards the hinterland, the lone island of Shanghai became a besieged city. People inside of the city wanted to get out, but people outside the city wanted to get in. American J.B. Powell did not want to leave, but the European Jews persecuted by Nazi Germany longed for a home in Shanghai.
On March 28, 1939, a Jewish boy named Ernest Heppner arrived here in Shanghai with his mother. For them, Shanghai was a completely alien place. They couldn't speak any Chinese. They couldn't even speak English. And all they had between them was 80 cents.
Ernest came from Breslau, Germany. His father was a successful businessman. They had led a happy and prosperous life. Then came Hitler and the Nazis. After their synagogue was burned during the infamous Kristallnacht, the family decided to flee Germany. But they could only get two tickets. Ernest and his mother boarded a ship bound for Asia, leaving his father and sister behind. They knew that while they had escaped Nazi Germany, most nations had closed their borders to them. Shanghai was the only metropolis that remained open to the Jewish refugees. The arrival of those well-dressed but mostly penniless refugees was a shock to Shanghai's remaining foreign population.
I was shocked to see, first time in my life, poor Europeans. I had never seen that. The poor people we saw were the Chinese and the white Russians who were living in Hankyu, but never the sophisticated. They were doctors and lawyers and dentists and very sophisticated people. And that's when we heard about Hitler, what he was doing to the Jewish people. And that's when we were aware of it closely.
It was a peculiar sight, as recorded by Ernest Heppner.
Assisted by coolies in rags, well-dressed gentlemen and ladies in fur coats and hats gingerly walked up the plank of a truck that looked and smelled as if it had been used to carry pigs.
Ernest and his mother were taken to a reception center in a large building facing the Suzhou River. Two floors had been converted into emergency shelters furnished with cots. It was called the Embankment Building. It was owned by Victor Sassoon, one of the wealthiest Jews in the world. Sassoon, the Jewish tycoon, permitted several floors of his Embankment Building to be used as a reception center. Ernest and his mother lived at the Embankment Building for only 2 weeks because Jewish refugees kept flooding in, and the Embankment Building could not host them all. They moved to Hongkou, or Hongkou, as it was known then. Hongkou in the late 1930s was an ugly and depressing place to live. In 1937, the Battle of Shanghai had left stretches in complete or partial ruins. But Hongkou satisfied two major needs of the refugees: low rents and cheap food.
Most importantly, the people in Shanghai are welcoming. You know, in some places in the world, if you walk around as a proud Jewish person, you may be attacked. But here in Shanghai, totally the opposite. There's no anti-Semitism in Shanghai. There's no anti-Semitism in China. And this is a very good feeling. Only a person who went through this can understand.
Many European refugees quickly recovered from the initial shock and horror and picked up their optimism. Emerging from the ruins of despair, they opened shops, bakeries, and cafes. They contributed to the remarkable transformation of their part of Hongkou. A revitalized Zhoushan Road would become the commercial hub of Little Vienna. Ernest Heppner spent his days roaming the streets of Shanghai. He wrote down his delightful discovery.
The philosophies of Confucianism, Buddhism, and Taoism never taught hatred or contempt for other religions. It seemed we had found a haven, a country without anti-Semitism.
Well, the young Ernest Heppner was living here in the embankment building and familiarizing himself with his new surroundings. The Japanese were steadily increasing their pressure on the international settlement. One of their main goals was to control the flow of information in and out of the city and to block the distribution of newspapers that published articles that ran counter to their own interests. Therefore, after occupying the district of Hongkou, they immediately seized the central post office.
Japanese troops committed appalling atrocities during the invasion of China. In order to suppress news about events that did not cast a good light on their activities in China, Japanese authorities imposed strict censorship to all mail coming in and out of Shanghai. J.B. Powell's The China Weekly Review was a prime target for the Japanese. In the Japanese-controlled areas, the newspaper had already been banned. In 1940, France fell to the German invasion. The government of Vichy France now sided with Japan. The lone islet of Shanghai's foreign concessions shrank further as the international settlement became the sole refuge for anti-Japanese activists. The Japanese pressure was enormous. But the Jewish refugees were still coming to Shanghai. Travel was becoming more and more difficult, and the sea route had already been sealed off. The only route to Shanghai was by train through Siberia. Ilo Korotkowski, a 16-year-old Jewish girl, arrived in Shanghai with her parents in July 1940. Their life was comparably better than most refugees. But the sudden transplant from a comfortable, familiar surrounding into a strange and foreign environment was devastating for Ilo's mother. She would not attempt to socialize with the neighbors. She refused to go outdoors. It would take years for Ilo to realize that her mother was actually suffering from clinical depression, a psychological toll for many Jewish refugees. For Ilo, an English-speaking teenager, adjustment to life in Shanghai was relatively easier. She quickly joined a Jewish youth group and found a job. She also started dating a young man she met at work, Ernest Heppner. Unknown to the happy Jewish couple, Shanghai had become a hotbed for Japanese-sponsored urban terrorism. In July 1941, attacks on Americans and other foreign newspapermen commenced. J.B. Powell's name was on the top of the Japanese blacklist. On 21st August 1941, in a letter to a friend in the United States, J.B. wrote,
"The situation here is gradually getting worse. So we are all living in constant expectation of either being kicked out or shut up in a concentration camp. The Japanese are getting nastier and nastier. Seems to me it is only a matter of time until something serious happens."
At around 7 p.m. on the night of October 23, 1941, J.B. Powell had just left his office and was on his way home. He was on the corner of Sichuan Road and Fuzhou Road when all of a sudden an object hit him on the left shoulder. He looked down, and to his shock and horror, he found a live hand grenade wrapped in newspaper. The cord had been partway pulled out, and it was a miracle that he escaped unharmed. Later on, nobody came forward to claim responsibility for this botched and cowardly attempt on Powell's life. But the message was clear enough.
A few days after the attack, a man having close connections with the Japanese called on J.B. and suggested that he should sell the China Weekly Review. J.B. Powell angrily rejected that offer. In late 1941, Nazi Germany had most of Europe, and its army was amassing at Moscow. Japanese forces had captured all major Chinese cities along the coast and were still pushing inland. It seemed only a matter of time until a war broke out in the Pacific between Japan and America. The U.S. State Department frequently reiterated its warning to all Americans in China that they should return to the United States. Many evacuated Shanghai, most of them never to return. But Powell decided to stay in the besieged lone island of Shanghai.
I don't think that the Westerners thought that the Japanese would treat them the same way they treated the Chinese, that he didn't understand how much danger he was in. The other thing, though, is he didn't want to go back to Missouri. He did everything he could to get out of there, and going back to Missouri would have, you know, what would he have done there? You know? He didn't have a life back in Missouri anymore. His life was in Shanghai. That's where he had built his life. And I think it was, and I think that's why he died.
To many residents of Shanghai, a clear sign happened in November, which was the departure of the U.S. 4th Marines. The U.S. 4th Marine Regiment had been protecting U.S. interests in Shanghai for 14 years. They were known by many as the China Marines. Now they were ordered to move to the Philippines. Powell watched the Marines leaving and wrote an article in the Review. In the same issue, he wrote an editorial titled, "War Looms Over Pacific." That was his last issue of the China Weekly Review. On the morning of December 8, 1941, J.B. Powell was awakened by several large explosions. The blast seemed to come from the Bund. Hurriedly putting on his clothes, he ran downstairs towards the Bund. The road was already blocked by Japanese soldiers in full war equipment with bayonets fixed. The Japanese struck and sank British and American gunboats moored in the Huangpu River. Japanese troops marched across Suzhou River and posted sentries at all major intersections in the international settlement. A few hours earlier, the Japanese Navy had raided Pearl Harbor, the U.S. naval base in Hawaii, and destroyed most of the American Pacific Fleet. Japan and America were officially at war. The lone islet of Shanghai gave way to full Japanese occupation.
Soon after the Japanese took over the entire city of Shanghai, Americans and Europeans were all carefully registered. And if you were an enemy national of the Japanese Empire, you had to go around wearing a red armband like this one, A for American. The British wore a B, the Dutch wore an N, and other nationalities wore an X. And you were banned from any public place of entertainment, including the race course, the nightclubs, and of course, the cinema.
The party was officially over for the international settlement. For the first time, Europeans and Americans in Shanghai were directly involved in the war in China. For the Americans and British who had enjoyed lives of great privilege and power in the city, life was now different. Their bank accounts were frozen, their shortwave radios and even their binoculars were confiscated, and they were eventually put in internment camps.
他们在上海大大小小的集中营20个。 比较著名的一个是现在的上海中学，它整个的这么大一个学校变成了一个集中营。再有像大厦大学，现在的华东师大、中山西路、中山北路的那个校区，还有像世西中学，还有江湾的一些空间，这个都做了所谓的敌侨的集中营。他把这个欧美，特别是英国、美国。
The British and the Americans were the elite. They were tops. They were wealthy. They lived in beautiful villas in Hangzhou. And so suddenly they were in a camp guarded by Japanese soldiers, and they had to wait in line to get their food. There was no clothing. They were bare feet. It was psychological, very difficult for them.
For J.B. Powell, who had openly opposed the Japanese, a more dangerous future awaited. The Japanese quickly seized Powell's residence at the Shanghai American Club on Fuzhou Road on Pearl Harbor Day. The office of the China Weekly Review was shut down. And Powell was put in a car and driven across Suzhou River to the north.
J.B. Powell was taken here. Today, it's a quiet residential apartment building. But back in the early 1940s, it was the most feared place in all of Shanghai. For this was the headquarters of the secret Japanese police force known as the Kempeitai. All around me were cells specially built for political prisoners. And once you entered here, it was impossible to get out without being seriously harmed.
From 1937 onward, the existence of Bridge House Prison in the Japanese-controlled Hongkou district was kept a profound secret. Many Chinese who disappeared from the international settlement had been thrown into jail here. Many of them would not walk out alive. Powell was questioned day and night by his captors. Most of the questions were about articles he wrote against the Japanese and the puppet Chinese government in Nanjing.
They were very angry at him, and they were very unhappy with his editorial policy of the review, and they intended to punish him very severely, and they did. In the Japanese prison camp, he had gotten the gangrene in his feet because his feet had frozen in the cell, and he was forced to sit in one position for long periods of time, and they lost blood circulation in his feet, and gangrene set in, and they swelled up, and he lost a lot of weight and became very ill.
Back in the United States, Powell's family tried desperately to rescue him. They wrote letters to the University of Missouri, a U.S. senator, and even the State Department. Preoccupied by the war with Japan, the U.S. government was too busy to concern itself with the plight of J.B. Powell. And rumors spread that Powell was already executed on espionage charges. In Hongkou, the Jews were devastated by the news that Japan had now declared war on America.
Every day, the papers reported new Japanese victories in the Pacific theater of operations, and the mood of the refugees bordered on hysteria. We simply could not accept the bad war news. We were not prepared mentally or physically for a long war or the possibility, however remote, of a Japanese victory.
In his memoir, Ernest Heppner writes in vivid and fascinating detail about the lives of the stateless Jewish refugees here in Shanghai. One of their greatest fears was the growing alliance between the Germans and the Japanese. And they were deeply disturbed with any news of Japanese victories in the Pacific theater. And soon rumors were spreading around the Jewish community that one of the most notorious chiefs of the German Gestapo had arrived in Shanghai.
The rumor turned out to be true. Gestapo Colonel Josef Albert Meissinger, known as the Butcher of Warsaw, came to Shanghai in 1942. Meissinger was dispatched to pressure the Japanese and advise them on exterminating the Jewish population. Ernest Heppner and his fellow Jews didn't know the exact plan of the Meissinger proposal. They didn't know that Colonel Meissinger also brought with him Zyklon B gas, a pesticide which had first been used in September 1941 in a faraway place called Auschwitz. But they knew what the Japanese were capable of doing, what the Japanese and Germans would do to the Jewish refugees in Shanghai was anybody's guess. In 1943, the Japanese made a proclamation that the stateless refugees, Jews who had been stripped of national citizenship by Nazi Germany, would be moved to a designated area.
The proclamation took effect on May 18, 1943. The ghetto area totaled less than 3/4 of a square mile. It housed more than 18,000 Jewish refugees, amongst perhaps 100,000 Chinese, twice the population density of Manhattan.
The Jewish refugees, who had overcome great obstacles in their exodus out of Europe and had found a means of livelihood and residence, were now forced to leave their homes and businesses again and to relocate into a crowded, squalid area. Moving to the ghetto was devastating for Ilo's mother. The worries about where the next meager meal might come from, the cramped conditions, and the constant fear that they might be rounded up and killed, all added to her depression. In July 1944, she contracted bacillary dysentery. There was no medication to be had. She died 3 days later. She was only 44 years old. The sudden death of Ilo's mother brought them closer than ever. The young couple spent night after night talking about their chances of surviving the war and the ghetto. Although they grew progressively more pessimistic about their future, that didn't stop them from getting married.
Ilo's wedding dress was made from a pair of white curtains her mother brought from Berlin. The wedding gift Ilo requested was to buy enough hot water for her to take her first warm bath in years. She soaked in the tub until it was almost too late to leave for the makeshift synagogue.
When they were standing under the chuppah, the air raid alarm sounded. Nobody cared, and the ceremony carried on. Ernest and Ilo were married on April 8, 1945. 1 month later, Nazi Germany surrendered. 3 months after that, Japan surrendered. The war was finally over.
I was pushed into this dark enclosure. I fell over someone lying next to the door.
And if they had amputated his feet, which would have been a much easier thing to do and would have saved his life and saved him a lot of pain and agony, but he didn't want that because he wanted to be able to walk away. I think he planned to walk back to China.